addition on my drawing, highlighted on my drawing here, and then this shaded area is the access road for the fire lane. I'd be glad to answer any questions I can.
Appreciate the problem you have with the projections on enrollment. What we're getting, and I've been on the planning board long enough, is appreciated. And it's got to beg the question, I think, is this sound planning? My major concern is that we're kind of locking ourselves into a series of temporary buildings. Now, I walk that site very, very frequently, and they look good. I mean, I'm not saying that there's anything negative about it. They look good, but they are temporary. And as I said, when we put the first one up, my concern was that temporary will become permanent, and how will they function in that vein when they now become a permanent building on site in what is becoming a bit of a sprawling campus setting. And so I guess I'd like to delve a little bit deeper into the thought process and the analysis that went on in the presentation to the school board of this needed temporary structure, and that thought process vis-a-vis what must be, from looking at your figures, some vacant space in the high school building. Could you give us some idea as to whether that process of thinking really was explored? What I'm saying is there any thought of temporary use of high school facilities in lieu of these now three temporary buildings you're talking about, and why that wouldn't work?
Yes, we explored several alternatives. One was the use of the high school, which is well known, has approximately 151,000 square feet. We received very little enthusiasm from the parents to moving the eighth grade pupils there. The school is so designed that if we were to move them there, we would have to integrate them with 9th, 10th, and 11th, 12th graders. That is not too appealing to first the board and the parents. Number two, we gave some thought to bringing the kindergarten youngsters there and occupying a certain amount of square footage. That would split our new K-5 organization into three schools, and professionally, it didn't appear to be the kind of solution we wanted, because we'd worked so hard to establish a K-5 organization that was sequential, and we were just getting that established. We looked at the bus garage, which many years ago was used as six classrooms, only to find that the cost would be excessive. We would have to put bathrooms and a host of others. We also looked at remodeling the internal parts of the middle school by making the IA room and moving the music and cutting that up. And the board spent a great deal of time looking at our plans and didn't accept that because that didn't seem very feasible. So we have explored all the alternatives, and the criteria was to maintain our K-5 organization, find the cheapest cost to the citizen, and as we all know, while portables are temporary, the town builds them, the state pays us per square footage, and over a period of 5.2, give or take, years, they pay for themselves. From the superintendent's point of view, that's one kind of state aid that we can take full advantage of, and we do not get the kinds of state aid that poorer communities get. So all in all, we've explored all the alternatives, and we find this to be the best one. Does that answer your question, sir?
Yeah, kind of.
One of the questions that then issue begs is that what is happening to enrollment? And as we follow your enrollment, your superintendent's report for April 1990, you see the definite bump in the elementary, fourth, fifth, and sixth grade classes beyond what you had in those classes last year that you could project. Example, last year in the fourth, the second grade, you had 144 students, and this year you have 158 in the next grade, the third grade class. Is that what you're experiencing, and why you're expressing the need for middle school facilities that are first temporary?
Yes, the bulge is moving into the middle school, and that's where we plan to or hope to put the portable. A concern I would bring to your attention is that we'd anticipated 110 kindergarten youngsters for next year. A year ago at this point, we had 90 registered. Today, we have 130. Now, we're extremely concerned that there's a possibility of another bulge coming into the school. The school board has mentioned to the council that if this is the case, we should give some serious thought to some long-term solution. And at this point, it's premature to say what that might be. But if our kindergarten enrollments are going to go 130 or more, we certainly better get a committee ready to come up with a solution, because it would take approximately 3 to 4 years to build some kind of a structure to house our enrollments.
When you were here 3 or 4 years ago in the first temporary classroom, the building between the Lund School and Pond Cove Elementary, and the question that Ivan raised at that time was the concern for temporary becoming permanent. There was a feeling that there was a bulge moving through the school system and that it happened to hit the elementary, and then it would be hitting the middle school, and then it would be hitting the high school. And as I remember those discussions, that bulge was perceived as a temporary bulge, and that you were moving to take care of that bulge wherever it was, and when it got to the high school, there was sufficient space there so that you wouldn't have a problem with space for those students. Is that bulge becoming a permanent feature in our school system? Yeah, bump instead of a bulge.
I think that's probably a pretty good way to articulate it. It's a bump on a bulge, apparently. However, our high school can handle certainly the enrollments that we see going there. And we anticipate that 1996, that should level off, and our high school enrollments at that point would start up again. However, the real concern is the kindergarten enrollment coming in. And if there's a bulge over the bump and another bulge, then we're probably in trouble. And we should give some serious thought to some very long-term plans.
The last year's senior class had 141 students in it, by your report here. And is that a correct reading of your report that last year, the high school, 12th grade, had 141 students?
Right.
Okay. Those 141 students, and then grade 11 was 127, and you can follow it right back for last year. How did we, as a town, take care of that senior class when they are in the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade? Or was there an expansion that occurred during the high school years? How did we accommodate 141 students in grade 7 6 years ago?
I can only say that the class sizes probably were larger, and our programs have changed significantly. For example, 5 years ago, we didn't have computer rooms. At the present time, we have two computer labs at the middle school, two at the high school. Our special education program has grown significantly in the last 10 years, and specifically in the last six. 10% of our students are in special ed, so that's taken a great deal of room. So I imagine that at that point in time, class sizes were a little larger than they are now. Policies changed in the past 5 years to reduce those class sizes. And at the same time, space is diminished because of additional programs.
Okay. And that really isn't the purview of the planning board and is directly the purview of the school board and through its funding mechanisms, the council, and what programs are desired. We needed an explanation of what was happening to the school population. I think you provided that. There may be some additional questions on that issue. Has there been thought to the changing some of the school programs to accommodate some of the bulges rather than new spaces being required? You know, obviously, it must have. You wouldn't
yes, and at the present time, we're just working on the budget, and we're making cuts, and we're not certain exactly where we're going to end up. However, it's our best view that to maintain the kind of programs we want, the four additional classrooms, and I don't want to say that would suffice for a number of years, because I said that last year, and 76 youngsters came into town. However, the best view we have, this should enable us to move that bulge, at least the one we presently have, into the high school. What happens from the kindergarten to the births is something that's pretty hard to predict.
Have you compared the price of temporary classrooms to permanent classrooms in terms of their square foot cost or?
Yes, for example, if we were to, if we were to build something permanently, I'm not sure that we would be able to receive a great deal of state aid because of our high value. Number two, the portables, as you know, are paid by the state, rented from the town. So the cost is minimal. Matter of fact, the cost is practically zero. After 5.2 years, they're paid off. What we can do with them in 5.2 years, I'm not certain, but they would belong to the town. They could be sold. There are a number of organizations now renting them to other communities because they are portable.
Okay, other planning board members.
Judith. Well, I have a couple of things. Number one, I think answer your question about what happened to our high school seniors when they were in junior high school. I have a high school junior, a fifth grader, and a third grader. When Kendall was in junior high school, in the middle school, all that was there was 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. Now we've got 5 grades in the middle school, or 5 levels that are there. I can remember when the Lunt School was closed for either a year or two. That Lunt building just was completely closed down. There was no heat, nobody went into it. So I've seen this bubble come and go. The next thing I wanted to say was that I think, second what you said, Dick, is that we have a terrific school board. And I'm sure they've beaten this whole thing six ways to Sunday of how to figure out what to do. And if indeed there is a bubble on a bump on a bubble, then we're going to have a new school somewhere. And that's their problem. But when the superintendent of schools comes here and says that they need a portable classroom, I think you probably need a portable classroom. And our problem, our job is to make sure they put it up so that everybody's safe and secure. And it meets all the codes. And I'm sure our school board, if they've sent him this far, let's just get it done.
Other comments by planning board? Tom?
A couple questions. What grade are these classrooms to serve?
Well, we're going to place them at the middle school. So what we're going to do is use 7th and 8th graders. We'll use those classrooms. And we'll move the 4th, 5th graders into what is presently 6, 7, and 8. In other words, we're putting them where the bulge is going and making some movements down below.
So this is a tricky one. I don't want to get into architectural design review here, but I'm familiar with the middle school concept, and I want to be sure that if we're adding on to a school again, it's probably a building committee issue or something else, but we don't have the fourth graders and the eighth graders intermingling unnecessarily, and if there's something about the site plan review that ought to pick that up, then that's all I'm trying to discover. As we're adding more classroom, are we doing anything with the site? Is there any additional recreation facility or anything like that that's also proposed, or any additional landscaping?
No.
In your opinion as superintendent of schools, is there any need for additional accommodation of outdoor recreational space or any improvements to the outdoor?
No, I see none whatsoever at this point.
In terms of the notion of portable classrooms, I guess the popular image of a portable classroom is one that is maybe a double-wide unit that's been converted into classrooms and often cases require students to leave their building, walk across a campus, whether it's 20 feet or further in the outdoor area, and then go into these portable classrooms. And I don't know whether they go from one school to the other or whether, in fact, they stay there with their teachers all day long. The greater question comes, and I guess this gets back to the whole issue of what Dick raised earlier, is portable versus permanent, and I don't know how you answer this. It seems to me that if we're attaching a building to an existing building, there's fire code issues to be dealt with there, fire separation requirements, I'm assuming, probably flashing requirements. That's a pretty permanent condition. What is the foundation treatment for these buildings? Are they on a frost wall or are they on pylons?
I would like to have the architect answer that.
No, they're on sonotubes.
Yeah.
And I might add, the drawings that you have been approved by the health office, so they have been approved. We're going to extend the sprinkler system into the building. That's one of the reasons why we are physically attaching it. And as an attached building, then, for example, we don't have to add independent facilities for plumbing, for example. In other words, if the building was like the bus garage, as the superintendent mentioned, one of the problems with the bus garage is it won't meet codes. It's a separate individual building and therefore becomes what's known as a self-contained unit, and therefore we have to add toilet facilities, which are not there. Whereas this one is, as you mentioned, physically attached and therefore considered code-wise as a part of the existing.
Has the addition, existing school been made thoroughly handicapped accessible?
Yes.
And
the lobby area that we have at the back of that building right now, in this area here, is at grade. This building at here would be down some steps, but the physical handicap would have access there.
And presumably access into the rest of the building is,
yes,
also fully handicapped.
Mm-hmm. All of the buildings in, I believe now, are all of the facilities we have at Cape Elizabeth.
In the fire marshal's review, is that reviewed for what he sees, or is there a special consideration because it's a temporary structure? Is that review any different, whether it's permanent or temporary?
I really can't answer that. All I'll say is I look at it as being meeting the codes as if it were a permanent facility, and I'm pretty sure he does. I didn't ask him. I look at it for life safety and the NFPA 101 exits code, and that's what it, and we review it. So whether it were temporary or we look at it as a permanent facility to meet life safety codes. There's no exceptions to that.
One question to the town planner. Is there anything in our ordinance that differentiates between a temporary and permanent structure?
Again, under site plan review, there isn't.
Is there?
There may be.
Anywhere in the zoning ordinance?
I don't think in zoning. Again, it might go back to the building code. I can look right now just to see. I don't think there is anything to differentiate between the two.
Okay. Other planning board comments or questions? Ivan.
Yeah, I hate to keep sounding like I'm beating a horse here, but I sympathize with the problems that you're experiencing in terms of this bulge, but I would, I'm sure looking at construction this summer, so it's ready for next fall. I'm sure that's what this is. Yeah, I would certainly, as one planning board member, like to send a message back to the school board that we'd like to see a committee or something established to do some long range planning. I hear what you're saying in terms of state aid to get these units built, the minimum cost, and all that's very, very interesting in a time of tight budgets, and I can appreciate that, working for the University of Maine system as I have. But this occupies probably the most important central part of the town, and as you sat through some of the meetings that we've had earlier, we've been beating private property owners over the head with what we're looking for in terms of landscaping and other improvements to make sure the center of town conforms to what we're looking at in the comprehensive plan. And I think we have to be just as diligent with the town staff, school board included, in terms of what this central town is going to look like. And frankly, as a planning board member, I'm concerned with a school now that's becoming a significant percentage of the floor space temporary building. And I'd be less than honest if I didn't tell you that. So if we go towards approving this, which we may do, I'd like to send some kind of a message through to the proper authorities in town, be the school board or the town council, I'm not sure how we do this, to get some planning started on where we're headed with our school property.
Good comment.
Mr. Chairman.
Steve.
Excuse me. How many students will these four classes serve? Approximately 80 or so?
Approximately 80. Our class size there is 20 to 24, mm-hmm. So give or take.
I get two major concerns that I'm looking at, although I have the same general concern about the temporary. Last year, I think one of the conditions of the temporary classrooms that we approved was that it would go into a five-year review, and it already looks like the five-year review is not going to be the end of the temporary characteristic of that, nor does looking at the population, school population, look like 5 years. At the end of 5 years, these will have outlived their usefulness. The two items that I'm really concerned about are fire or safety access. It seems like we want to get this barely minimal road around the backside, which I think is absolutely necessary. I was just out there yesterday in the athletic field looking back at that back end of the temporary section. It's a real maze of buildings back through there. It's a real minimal space to get a fire truck or any emergency vehicle between the bus garage and whatever that building is with the smokestacks out of the back of it. Okay. I think if you're looking at this expandable campus that seem to be designing, then we've got to have access roads, year-round access roads for safety reasons all the way around the facility. My other concern is that the town engineer, makes mention that there is no water or sewer in the new section. And he mentioned sprinkler system, which must be a dry system. But I'm looking at the T.Y. Lynn, our town engineer. I take it that doesn't mean no drinking fountains, or we must have water in the classroom areas.
No, there's no water, public water into that. There'll be no extension of water into that area other than through the sprinkler system. It is a wet system, so the sprinkler system will just be an extension of the existing.
What type of classes are you going to have in those classrooms? Some of this doesn't seem to be our purview, but I mean, if you're having an art class, or I mean, you walk through classrooms and teachers have these little sinks in all of them. You know, how do they wash their hands?
No, we won't have art classes or classes that require water.
How about chemistry?
No, those labs will be in a different spot. Those will be used primarily for classes like French, English.
Dry classes.
I've never quite heard that terminology, but that sort of fits the bill.
We've come up with a number of new terms for you, too. Other comments, Steve?
Not this time, no.
Other comments by board members? What are the wishes of the board?
First for application completeness.
Yes.
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 And Mr. Chairman, if I may, just to go through it, with the submission of the new materials, a lot of the items which I had rated as being partial or had left blanks, start to become addressed.
Let me also explain to the board why that was submitted tonight. The town planner had requested that information to be supplied. It was supplied this evening, and my understanding is that those plans have been reviewed by a public works director and the fire chief in terms of the fire lane, and that both are in concurrence that they are appropriate for approval by the planning board.
I realize we don't have a motion before the board, but could I ask a question of
absolutely
timing? What are you looking for in terms of timing and schedule? Are we at the 11th hour, the 10th hour, quarter to 12? Where are we?
It's actually 10 to 7. Ivan is asking.
Our timing?
Yeah.
Hopefully that we could start right the day after school stops and have it ready for beginning of school in September.
So you would need approval from this board by when, I guess? Well, you're hoping to get it tonight. I mean, if you didn't get it tonight, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get some time into this process. We've got a set of plans in front of us that we've had a chance to take a look at, but a lot of the items are incomplete on the checklist. I'm just wondering whether we have time to go take a look at the site and maybe even possibly have a workshop with some school board people, if that's appropriate. Do we have time for that?
Well, we've been approved by the zoning people. We need approval for the council for the money. And we're in the process. We've met once with them, and we're going to meet again. The board is going to meet on May the 2nd with them. It was our hope that we would accomplish, get all the permissions as soon as possible. So I suspect that, one moment, because my business manager knows that timing far better than I, and he talks to the builder all the time.
Dee, what's the latest? We had hoped that we get approval tonight. Like Dr. Pelletier just stated, we still have to sell the concept, or in the process of selling the concept to the town council. The bid process and everything else that would fall into place would be like probably late May, with school ending like the 15th or 16th of June. The zoning board gave us three conditions to the approval. One is that we do not start prior to the end of school, which is the day after. Two is that we do come back in 5 years for a review. And three is that we do fence in the area for construction. Mr. Armitage noted you to the fact that we did get the fire marshal's approval on the building itself. It will be sprinkled to meet all the codes. The middle school, the whole building is sprinkled, so we need to do that. We would hope to get approval tonight.
Has the project been bid yet?
No.
You competitively bidding that to a number of builders?
Last year, our first year, we got like four or five bids, I think three last year. But there's a lot of the companies that are into the affordable construction are just calling us up every week and see what's going on and things of the sort. We need to gear up and get, like the builder, we need to gear up and get the trusses, built by whoever's going to do them. The planning of this is quite crucial because it does take like 8 weeks to put it up. It's built on site.
If I can summarize and see if I'm wrong, then what you're saying is that approval is desired tonight, that you'll be meeting with the council on May 2nd for funding, be going out to bid in the interim period after you receive funding, giving them 2 to 3 weeks of bidding, so you're late May by the time the bids come back, you're awarding a contract at the end of May, and you're starting construction 2 or 3 weeks later. Materials being ordered as soon as the bid is awarded. Correct. Does that give a timing?
I figured that would be what it was, so just wanted to ask them.
I think we were about here last April also.
Oh, that's right.
April's a hot month.
I remember well. Yeah.
Other comments by board members?
Question about the main entrance to the building. It's the link between the existing building and the temporary building. I don't see anything on the exterior that relates to that. Are the students supposed to wait outside the building in the morning and then go in through that entrance? Is that a separate entrance for those classrooms?
Uh, actually, the bus bussing the students to school, they dropped off at this location here, in between the substation, Great Wing, and the middle school.
Mm-hmm.
So this is just an extension of the that lawn that you have there is basically for exercise.
Okay.
Is there any requirement to provide an outside stoop outside a fire egress? Does there have to be an area, a paved area outside a fire egress?
It will be paved, but there's no access.
What are the wishes of the board?
Okay. Can I skip application completeness?
7A or 7B should be the first motion.
Okay. Okay, be it ordered that the site plan application for the temporary four classroom addition to the middle school as proposed by the Cape Elizabeth School Department is deemed to be complete in accordance with section 19-2-9 sub D of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
You've heard the motion. Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
Motion is seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed? Is a 3-2 vote in the affirmative for a complete application. Next motion on the site plan approval process. Anyone wish to make a motion? Judith.
Be it ordered that the request of the Cape Elizabeth School Department for site plan approval to construct a temporary four classroom addition to the middle school be granted in accordance with section 19-2-9 and the facts presented. Do we make it still subject to that? If
sure.
That on there?
Mm-hmm.
Subject to the following conditions: that the design and construction of the 10-foot-wide fire lane shall be undertaken by the school department in consultation with the public works director and the fire chief. That the fire lane shall be maintained and kept passable by emergency vehicles on a year-round basis. That the fire lane entrance located next to the bus garage shall be kept clear and unblocked by parked school buses, and that a new site plan application be submitted to the planning board in 5 years if the temporary classroom is still in use at this future point in time.
You've heard the motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Okay.
Now, is there open for discussion?
Any further discussion?
Okay. I'd like to propose an amendment to Part D, and I'd like to talk this one through before we put it to words. Instead of a new site plan application be submitted to the planning board in 5 years, I'd like to propose an immediate start on a planning effort, which could include the planning board and other appropriate boards in town. I assume the school board might be one of them, to look at this entire campus that we now have and review its appropriateness to the current school and projected school population. In other words, what I'm saying is it's time we started looking at this on a longer term basis than 9 months out, because otherwise I'm afraid that next year at this time we'll be looking at exactly the same thing again.
Might I suggest, Ivan, that that's a good suggestion, and I think that that should be taken to the school board and to the council as a recommendation of the planning board, and an offer of planning board assistance in that committee process. That does have to become a creature of the council,
mm-hmm.
and I would think that we would want to hold that as a separate item, as a distinct recommendation to the council, so that our approval process doesn't become conditioned on the council action that establishes that kind of committee. It
okay.
may be appropriate for
right.
a site plan to come back in 5 years. I think your comment is appropriate and good, and should be a strong recommendation to the council. I would
and
also
I'll withdraw my recommendation.
Okay.
That.
Okay. And your second stance?
Yes.
I would also encourage planning board members to go to the May 2nd meeting with the council and the school board to participate in that discussion and be a part of the process. That is on May 2nd, here at the town office. Presumably that's an open meeting.
Mr. Chairman, or Mr. Planner, at the last approval of the last temporary structure to be approved, it's also a five-year site plan review. Is that by ordinance? Is there any reason we pick 5 years?
No, what we're doing, what we've done actually for the last 2 years, this would be the third year, is we're the planning board would be mimicking to a degree the zoning board.
Matching.
Planning board, you know, the zoning board has said 5 years is roughly, you know, the time when I think they originally were told 2 years ago that, you know, that's about how long the lifespan would be. Mm-hmm. I think we now recognize it's probably going to be a little bit longer than 5 years. So the board could extend that beyond.
I was looking at shortening up by quite a bit. I don't like the proposal at all. I voted for completeness because I felt that the school board, the applicant, had their information here. There are technical merits that I don't agree with. I'm trying to ponder now whether it's worthy of a negative vote on the site plan approval. Most of my concerns have to do with the safety, the fire lane. I realize we have in there for construction. I can't understand why we're continuing to build temporary structures without water or without sewer facilities and not review them in less than 5 years. I guess it's just not making a lot of sense to me.
Let me, as a planning board member, respond as a planning board member, not necessarily as a chairman that's more interested in a process than in an issue. And just because a person sits in the chair doesn't mean he doesn't have opinions about the various issues. The temporary four-classroom addition, I don't think, is an issue that our school board wants or desires, but is required to address and bring to the community. There are needs in the community that the school board, in its own deliberations, has decided this is the most efficient and most expeditious manner to handle a problem that they have. It still must go before the council, where I would imagine the school board is going to have similar kind of comments from council members about the nature of temporary classrooms as they relate to bulges in population. What I've heard from the school board is this is not the way they would necessarily want to handle issues on a long-term basis. It is the best way to handle the issue on a short-term basis. Short-term being it is something that is needed for next year, and the temporary classrooms are a way to accomplish that. I personally think that the school board and council would welcome a joint process with planning board, council, and school board to address the long-term school needs and to make sure that other temporary classroom space issues don't become issues that are repeated before the planning board in the site plan process every other year or every year. In line with that, in line with the restrictions that they have and understanding as a town body those restrictions that they are faced with, and given the testimony this evening about the dry classrooms and it's an extension onto an existing building, and all of the facilities that are in the current buildings would be used by students that would be in these temporary classrooms for however many years, that it appears to me appropriate to raise the questions and deal with the issues as I think all of you have done tonight, and I share all of those concerns, and I think the school board members do as well, and I'm sure the council will at its May 2nd meeting. To the issue of approval or denial, it should be based on the technical merits of what is being proposed by the school department and not necessarily the issue of whether it's the most appropriate way we feel of handling the issue, because I clearly feel that I can't make that. I haven't attended the meetings or gone into the deliberations as they have. I'm prepared to vote for the motion that has been made, and with the proviso that you're expressing and that Ivan and Tom and others have expressed as well, that this is a tough situation. Tom?
A Tough situation is the correct term, I think, Dick. And I think the best measure is how do we treat other applicants in a similar situation. And, for instance, I doubt that we would approve a site plan where we're shown a road that's located a foot or two away from an existing building with no contour information. And in looking closely at the plan, T.Y. Lynn expressed concern about how drainage was going to work under the building and what effects that might have on moisture buildup underneath the floor and so forth. With the fire lane going in now, it really appears as though there'll be filling and cutting required on that hillside. I don't know what the implications of that are. If we're talking about a temporary situation being at least 5 years, I think that warrants additional site improvements that we would expect, just as we've asked Jonesy's to provide some screening and buffering, I think certainly for the benefit of children who are supposed to be appreciating Earth Day and the betterment of the environment. We should see slope stabilization on the drawing and those things. I would be willing to vote in favor of the site plan approval if there was an understanding that we might see some of that, some of those things presented to the plan. More specifically to the safety issue, I think the fire lane accessing so tightly between the existing building and the garage, it's really important to have some sort of striping out next to the school that indicates that that is a fire lane access, and appropriately at the other end, some sort of a sign that would indicate that that's a fire lane access and that parking should be restricted.
Excellent point, and maybe that's a new condition that might be added to the motion, that that be appropriately marked.
Mr. Chairman, just so you know, the fire chief has made that suggestion with respect to signage, so that will be done. Striping may be an additional item that could be added on.
How about parking of the school buses themselves? That's basically where they park. How many school buses park there?
As Mr. Tinsman said, the chief and we agreed that the buildings would have, as you've probably seen if you go to the mall or anything of that nature, you will see no parking signs, fire lane restrictions, and that will be the case, both up near the industrial arts building, down on the bus garage, and on the boiler room building that's adjacent to it. In response to the drive is located on the drawings where the fire chief would like to have the drive. That was, you know, his suggestion. I agree. I think the reason he likes it in that tight area is the concern for the public getting through the area. We talked about relocating the drive up to where the tennis courts were, and they have problems policing that area right now. So that's another concern outside of the fire lane. They don't want the fire lane to be anything other than a fire lane, if you will. So we didn't get into any, and before we started digging up a lot of earth and making a road out of it, we pretty much agreed that we would clear that area for and prep it for a, if you will, gravel drive for access as a fire lane. And that's why there are contours on there that is relatively flat area, with the exception of where the trees are at the rear of that building, and rather than getting into a lot of tearing down of existing trees, we're going to work with what we have to make it accessible.
I think that fire lane has to have not only no parking, but I think that has to be a tow zone. I mean, you face it, if anything parks in that area, you cannot get to that temporary classroom, right? If anything inadvertently parks in that fire lane, by the boiler room, you can't get to that building, can you?
You can't from the fire lane.
I know, but I mean, if it goes where you've got it.
This is strictly the buses don't park up, and you know they're going to have to be made aware of the fact, and obviously it's a school problem. Safety problem with the school, so the buses will have to park either in the garage or over here. This area will have to be kept open.
Exactly. So I'm saying no parking won't cut it. It's
going
to have to be a tow zone.
If a teacher were to park his car there, yes, it would get cut.
And otherwise, you're blocking it. I mean, there's no other way around.
Let me see if I can express this. Steve has been busily drafting and crossing words out as various board members have been discussing things. He has suggested in his language that subparagraph C, that the fire entrance lane located next to the bus garage shall be kept clear and unblocked by parked school buses, and has suggested the following additional language, and that striping shall be painted on the pavement indicating the no parking area with no parking zone signage also being placed in the area and along the fire lane.
And my suggestion is no parking and tow zone be added.
No parking tow zone. I didn't read it correctly. No parking tow zone.
With you.
Did the fire chief give any consideration to the fire lane as it runs beside the storage building in the wintertime? Is it a metal roof? Snow slides off the roof, sits in the middle of the fire lane. Less than optimum place for all of for the fire lane.
All he has done is requested that the road be kept open. I mean, that's going to have to be considered a fire lane. The area, this area here is already plowed in the wintertime, so it's just a matter of sending a plow down through there and open that, keep that open. Again, you have both concerns. You have the concern for fire, and you have the concern for public going down through there. So it's a control problem both ways. Once you plow the road, what's to prevent the, in some cases, for example, down in here, there's a fence area, you could have a crash gate and lock it and have to defend the man, but stop the truck, get out and lock it.
I guess as a planner, I'm much more concerned about a fire truck reaching that school than I am about an occasional car driving through. Yeah. I really, the public access, I realize it's a nuisance. We're talking about a fire hazard. In my opinion, reaching that school classroom area.
Judith.
When we approved last year the other one that's out back there, I didn't check it, but as I remember, we also approved it contingent upon there being kept open a fire lane that goes out around the, or a roadway of some type, around the football, the field,
the track
that goes out, the track. So actually, we have that fire lane, but we also have the fire lane that would come in and access across there. There are two ways to get to the rear of that building, if I'm not, if you put in the new fire lane.
Yes, exactly.
So it's not, not that, heck, we've got a second one, so we don't need this one, but it's not as if this something happened and they couldn't get through, there still is access to the back of that building by fire equipment.
The major concern that the chief has now is getting in here. This way here he has access to this building, this way here he has access to this building.
Mm-hmm.
What he wants to do is to be able to come down and come in through here. That's really, into the courtyard, if you will. That's what he really is concerned about.
Judith, I had read some language as addition to your motion.
Mm-hmm.
Is that appropriate, and would you incorporate that into your motion?
Can I do it by reference?
Yes. And Mr. Most, second. The motion has been made. It has been seconded. There has been substantial discussion. Are you ready for the vote? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? 3-2 vote. With different 3-2 in favor, yes. Go to it. Let's establish some long-term planning.
I appreciate your concerns, and I want you to know that the board members are here. You've heard them. Our chairman, Brent Vaughn, is here, and Charles Freer.
Could I just make my motion?
Yeah.
I think I would like to formalize in the form of a motion that the planning board make a recommendation to the school board and other appropriate boards in town that a long-range, in excess of 1 year, planning effort on the site of the middle school, elementary school, be undertaken for a review of that entire need in that area.
Motion has been made.
I'll second that.
And seconded. Any further discussion? With your permission, then, the chairman will write a letter to the chairman of the council and the chairman of the school board expressing that motion and that desire. And all those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. And opposed, Thank you very much.
Now you can manage.
Okay, it is 10:31. Our planning board rules require that we not take up a new item after 10 o'clock. We do have one other item of new business on the agenda, and that is a wetland alteration permit application by Joseph Higgins. I would ask the planning board to determine whether you wish to take this item up by making a motion to waive our planning board rules for taking up an item after 10 o'clock.
I so move.
It has been moved.
Seconded.
And seconded that we waive our rules for taking up item up after 10 o'clock. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, please raise your hand. And opposed? The unanimous vote.
I might make the comment that if Mr. Higgins has to come here again, if he gets put first, he's always last.
Well, hopefully Mr. Higgins won't have to come back.
He'll have to come back one more time for a public hearing. So the public hearing usually happens at the beginning of the meeting. So however, there are many public hearings that you've scheduled this evening. So.
Make sure.
The issue before us is an application by Mr. Higgins for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for his lot on Wood Road, and the setting of a public hearing for the wetlands alteration permit application. One of the issues is whether or not the application is complete. Maybe Mr. Higgins, you might present a short version of your application, and then Mr. Butler might comment on application completeness.
My name is Paul Lawrence. I'm representing Mr. Higgins. Very briefly, you all have the information before you. It's quite straightforward. This is just an enlargement to a 20 scale. The 40 is what you have. This is the unaltered site, 1 foot contour interval relative, and it shows basically the only water course feature in the upper right hand corner is a pre-existing subsurface drainage system that had been disconnected at such time that the sewer and storm drain went in. It is just a gentle slope toward the lower left hand corner, approximately 2 to 3% slope, relatively uniform. In the altered as proposed, we have the placement, right side up will help. We have the placement of the building, and the only alterations are the discontinuance of the subsurface drainage as it currently stands, replaced instead by a French drain. And that will be on the upper portion of the lot as you view it, between there and the house, running basically parallel to the house. The only alterations around the house are as necessary to bring the house up to grade and to grade from there back into the existing contours. There will be the catch basin set at the far end for sediment and erosion control. And the line will carry along this end of the house, and you'll have tie-ins made from the foundation drains at the house. And there is one area where the driveway will cross, and there'll be a small catch basin here. It's an opportunity that water could collect. There's no evidence of it at this time, but it's just a precaution, which it will also be tied in, and they'll all come into the storm drain, where there is a manhole at this point now. It's the most straightforward access.
Okay. Thank you.
That's about it.
Mr. Butler, application completeness.
Application completeness. Everything's complete. Was complete, and the materials that were submitted, except for evidence, right title, and interest. That was really something that had been relatively resolved when Mr. Higgins came before the board for the public access waiver. There are a couple items that need to be tied up still, and we've just been presented this evening with a deed document before us, which I haven't had a chance to look at. But again, I don't think it's a big issue for wetlands alteration, something, though, that the board may want to have wrapped up by the time it gets to granting the permit, if it indeed does that.
Was evidence of right title and interest a requirement, or did we receive data on that, on the public access waiver?
Yes.
Yeah,
so that test has already been complied with in terms of previous action by the planning board.
It was questioned and clarified.
Okay. What are the wishes of the board? Or are there any questions?
I have a question, Mr. Chairman. Is this, in fact, a wetland?
It's designated a wetland under the town, by the town jurisdiction. That's the only agency that has designated it. It's been declined by DEP and the Army Corps, and under the federal guidelines, it does not qualify. But because it is mass quantum soil, it falls under it as a designated.
What guidelines under Army Corps federal guidelines fail to meet the designated wetland classification?
Hydrology and wetland vegetation.
There's not adequate evidence of either high water table or wetland vegetation.
Only by the soil types as expressed on the site and as required by the town's ordinances. One of the developers gave us a unique definition of what a wetland was in the West, and I think you remember that on our site walk a little while ago, where if you put your ear to the ground and listen very hard, and if it gets wet, it's wetland.
If you put your ear to the ground and you can't breathe, it's the wetland.
That's right. We have a little more strict interpretation of what a wetland is here in Maine. Tom, does that answer your question?
It does. Could I continue to
sure.
comment? I see some inconsistencies here in that it's not a wetland, and the hydrology doesn't indicate it as a wetland, but you're using engineering methods that would indicate otherwise. The use of French drains and foundation drains, I think, are popularly accepted for moisture purposes, but intercepting the groundwater coming across the site seems an extraordinary measure to me.
The difference, again, with a wetland, to be classified as soil, we're talking about the water table being within 6 inches of the surface in order to meet that classification. The situation that we have here is that it is somewhat poorly drained, which means it is a matter of inches from 6 to approximately 15 within that range. Now, although it does not qualify for, as a wetland classification, it nonetheless, if you're trying to put a full foundation in, makes it extremely difficult when you're trying to work 4 to 6 below grade level, and you have a standing water table even within 20 inches of the ground. It's just a measure of trying to intercept the problem in a position where you can handle it a lot easier on an engineering basis before it gets into the structure.
Other comments or questions, Tom?
The only other question I would have is there a policy regarding similar situations as the planning board of the town faced a similar situation, whether we have something that the town has classified as a wetland coming before us? Do we have any legal parameters within which we should review this application?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I think it's the wetlands ordinance as it stands now is designed to treat major wetlands and relatively minor wetlands the same. So I think in terms of the process, Mr. Higgins needs to go through it, but in terms of meeting the tests, the standards that are in the ordinance relating to wetlands alteration, I would think if the board felt that this is relatively minor wetlands, that then the standards would most likely be easily met. So, I think the issue is if the wetlands alteration process is triggered, it needs to go through, but if it's truly not a major wetland, then I guess I wouldn't anticipate many problems with it, but that's for the board to decide.
Precedence, not necessarily. Other questions?
Only other question or comment. What would happen if someone came before us, again, this just for discussion, with a parcel that was four times the size that had a similar restriction, that there was a soil contour that was under the town's ordinance a wetland. And they had a choice of placing a building anywhere on the site, and I think the applicant's comment is a valid one. Just because you have wetland soils doesn't mean that they're necessarily unbuildable soils. How would the board be asked to review something like that? I mean, what I'm having trouble with is establishing a precedent where we're essentially we're calling it a non-dry land is what we're doing.
Let me address that, and Steve, correct me if this issue is wrong. And there has to be a little bit of history here, and I'll do it in 2 seconds. The existing ordinance allows the filling of up to 5,000 square feet of land area that is in a defined wetland. And this applicant has proposed that 5,000 square foot filling, plus I understand some more, although it is indeterminate how much more that is. So that's the issue that we're really facing under the existing ordinance. Under the new town ordinance, that new wetland ordinance passed by the town council, for which we will receive a briefing on May 1st by Steve Butler, there are no provisions for any filling of wetland areas under that ordinance, and I've got to look to you to see if that's correct. When the planning board passed that on to the council, we had a 1,000 square foot filling allowance.
Right.
And is there any at this point?
There's some allowance, but it's for existing residences, and there's not a set number. You can do it within 50 feet of an existing residential structure. Mr. Tinsman's correct. There is no up to 5,000 square foot exemption, so to speak, as there is now. If you fall into the wetlands alteration process and you don't have an existing home there, you at least have to go through the process.
Further to Tom's question, if we're under the new ordinance for this piece of land, would this house be allowed to be built on it?
I believe under the new wetlands ordinance, this would be classified a wetlands protection district, which would allow residential construction with a permit by the planning board. I believe that's correct.
Okay.
Does
that answer your question with both ordinances, Tom?
Yes. Has this been reviewed by the town engineer?
He's looked at it briefly, but I don't think he, in terms of wetlands alteration, he didn't think it was a big issue. He didn't look at the design aspects of the drainage system.
All of our planning board agenda items are reviewed by the town engineer.
Assuming that the plan I have in front of me, it appears it to be a contour plan. There seems to be a contour that comes in and splits and rejoins. And as far as I know, what I know about civil engineering, that's not possible, which would lead me to have some concern about where the surface water is being directed. I don't mean to make a big deal out of this, but I think we have to be consistent when applicants come before us that we have the same expectations or similar expectations for what would be.
Members of the planning board, I think we should be clear that tonight is a completion review, not a technical
completion
review.
Okay.
That we would be voting to hold a public hearing if it is deemed to be complete, and we'll presumably be doing that in a much earlier evening time than 10:45.
In that case, I have no further comments.
Okay. What are the wishes of the board?
Can I make a motion?
Please.
Be it ordered that the application of Joseph Higgins for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for one lot located off Wood Road is deemed complete in accordance with Section 19-3-9 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented. Be further ordered the Planning Board will hold a public hearing on this application at its May 15th meeting.
It has been moved.
Seconded.
And seconded. Is there any further discussion?
None whatsoever.
How appropriate. I will call for a vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you very much. We'll see you on May 15th at our public hearing. You're welcome.
Mr. Chairman, just a quick note, which can be addressed later. Another time is the issue of what happened to the last planning board meeting. I think it was the last one where there's some confusion about whether or not the board could waive the public access waiver, the driveway width of 22 feet. And there's some confusion, so the board waived it down to 20 feet. Turns out that that's something that really can't be done. That's the standard that's in the zoning ordinance. And anyway, so
okay.
We can deal with that next week.
No, we need to do that at this meeting. I believe if a move to reconsider a previous vote has to be accomplished at the next meeting. And it's a simple issue. We voted first to require 22 feet, and it was suggested strongly at that meeting that we consider 20. At the next meeting, we considered 20 and rescinded the previous vote and went to 20 feet. And now we find that we cannot waive that provision. So a motion for those voting affirmatively, by those voting affirmatively, would be in order to rescind our vote to allow a 20-foot way and still require the previously approved 22-foot way. And I would call for that motion.
I don't know how to make it. I
just say so moved.
So moved.
Thank you. Moved and seconded that we rescind our previous vote of 20 feet wide for the driveway and reinstitute the original requirement for 22 feet. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? One negative vote. Two? Tom, did you vote affirmatively? Okay. One negative vote.
Unprincipled.
Appropriately. Consistent statement.
Yes.
Thank you very much. We have one other item that is not a new business item, but relates to our workshop that we had. Has everyone had a chance to review the sewer ordinance memo that was prepared by Steve Butler and sent to all members? And the issue here is whether or not the planning board will authorize the chairman of the planning board to write a letter to the council recommending that we propose that subdivisions that would allowed to be built on on-site wastewater disposal systems be allowed to be provided with public sewer by planning board vote in line with Steve's memo.
I have only one very quick question, and that is, does this proposal, will the proposal indicating that it has to be approved first for subsurface disposal before it can be approved for sewer, is that going to meet with a resistance? Does that pose a problem?
For the applicant?
No. With any other ordinance that would not take... I just foresee the application process where the person has to go through the process of soil testing every site for the only purpose being to approve it for sewer. Is that the purpose of...
The purpose is to...
The process.
And we had had some discussions in our workshop. The purpose of the recommendation, as we talked about in the workshop, was to not allow increases in density over what would be allowed for on-site wastewater disposal. And this is a safety valve that is really of benefit to the public and the community by requiring full documentation on on-site subsurface waste disposal prior to any allowances by the town through its planning board to provide public sewer or requirement to provide public sewer.
So it not only the proposed application would have to conform with current zoning, but also current zoning as subsurface sewer requirements.
And I think that has some value. Because I think what will happen is the developer will now have an option to be able to make a fork in the road, so to speak. And once he's gone through the whole process of getting the site set for subsurface disposal, he could say, well, gee, you know, maybe it would be a better development if I went with the same number of lots. Now I've already determined what it is for subsurface. I'll use the same number of lots, but I'll go for sewer now, and I can place them differently. It allows you some flexibility in design that we don't have right now.
I agree. The density of our ordinance, the zoning ordinance, would take care of most of that, except for areas of poor soil.
Yeah, and that's where the calculation, I think, has to be done. I don't know how you can do it any other way.
And that was the desire of those who were there that night, that this be tied directly to on-site wastewater subsurface disposal so that we weren't arbitrarily increasing the potential for density.
Dick, one comment. This may come right out of left field, and I don't want it to, but the board hasn't addressed the issue of affordable housing yet, and as you know, affordable housing and sewers are very closely related in terms of density and so forth. At some point, I would hope that we could revisit this issue. I don't want to bog it down tonight, but perhaps in the future, if there are tremendous benefits being seen in being able to provide central system public sewer rather than on-site septic, and there's some real kind of public benefit, there may be a way in which we could tie affordable housing into that. Not massive developments necessarily, but individual houses located here.
And we need to deal with that issue. We've been trying for a couple of months to get to the affordable housing issue, and it's being replaced by a lot of applications that are before the town right now. But you're right, that's another issue that has to be addressed in relationship to public sewers. What are the wishes of the board? Do you wish to authorize a letter recommending such a move be made to the town council?
Does that require a motion?
Yes, it should be.
I move that the chairman of the planning board, looking for the wording, submit a letter to the town council proposing this change in the sewer ordinance as summarized in the memo from Steve Butler, April 15th, planning board.
It has been moved.
Second.
And seconded to write a letter to the council suggesting an ordinance change. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. And opposed? It is a unanimous vote. Are there any other issues to come before the planning board this evening?
Jerry? It appeared that Mr. Drinan was willing to give a site walk other than a May 12th, and I'm going to try to take time to do that at some point where we've got 7:30, 7 o'clock daylight during the year. I would like to try to do that within the week. If I set that up, if anybody on the board is interested in having me contact them to give them a date, so they may have another opportunity other than May 12th.
How many planning board members are not going to be able to be at the May 12th sidewalk?
I just find Saturday morning for me just to be frank about it. You know, it's the one day of the week that I get a chance to do something else.
Yeah.
And it takes 2 to 3 hours. So, again, creating something in, I would prefer to take the opportunity to make those sidewalks, especially this time of year when you get the late hours as far as the sun is concerned, sometime during the week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no problem with doing that. Ivan, are you going to be here?
I even get up at 7:30 in the morning and do it real early.
Are you going to be here in May 12th?
I haven't had no problem at 12.
Okay.
But as the summer starts to wear out, I would agree to be there.
Steve?
I'll be there Saturday.
Judith?
Tom?
I won't be in town on Saturday, so it would be, I think, real advantageous if we could coordinate something. So you'll contact him and give me a call? Great, thanks.
Okay, are there any other items to come before the planning board? Motion to adjourn would be in order.
Second.
Moved and seconded, we adjourn. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? There aren't anyone opposed.
No one. Not even me.